Well, it's wonderful to be here this morning. What a great venue. As John said, my name is John Mellor. I'm from Adobe. I've been in this industry for about 15 years, so I love events like this. You know, I sort of feel like I'm among friends, all of us that sort of beat our heads against the digital marketing wall and try and figure out what's next and try and figure out how to please our boss and our boss's boss. And today, that's what I want to talk about a little bit, is sort of our philosophy about digital marketing, sort of what we view as important and why we think that's important. This is my clicker here. So whenever I think technology is taking over a little too much, I've got this picture in my office, and I pull it out. And it reminds me of a principle that is very important today, just as it was 100 years ago. So to explain what this is, and sometimes I walk around the office and ask people, do you have any idea what this is? What's your idea? It looks like a casket for a cow or, pine wood particle accelerator, something. So anyway, nobody ever guesses what it is. And I say, well, to understand what this is, you have to go back about 100 years. You have to go back to another time when there was a lot of technology change. There were a lot of people focused on how to adapt this new technology. There was a big prize for the person who could understand and crack the technology code. And essentially, it was the technology of flight. Right? So back in the early 1900s, there were a lot of people trying to figure out, how do I get an airplane that people can actually fly in? And a lot of people were trying to crack this. And the sort of method of the day was to build full-size airplanes, take your best guess, hike that sucker up a mountain, and chuck it off a cliff. And the results were pretty binary. Either it worked or it didn't. But it was really expensive. It was expensive, it took a lot of time, and it just wasn't very efficient at all. And the Wright brothers came along and said, we have a better idea. We're going to do this thing called prototyping. And this is the wind tunnel that the Wright brothers used when they first figured out prototyping. So their approach was, well, let's take 200 ideas that are sort of our best guess, then let's get really critical on those and whittle those down to 38 ideas. Then let's put those 38 ideas in a wind tunnel, and let's see which one flies. And eventually, they, of course, came up with the one, and were the 1901, I believe, were the first ones to actually get a human on an airplane in flight. So what does that have to do to it, to today? Well, my message first is, let's don't build planes and throw them off cliffs. But the point is that the process of iteration is very much alive today. And it's very much a key principle of how we all do our jobs. It's a principle of success. The challenge for us is that our world is, of course, much different than people that were building airplanes. Our world is about data. The data that we live in is very, very rich, and it's inundating. And there's just coming at us from many sources. It's coming in huge volumes. It's new sources every day. We've got, seems like, a new social network, a new ad channel, a new video type, all coming at us every day. And our challenge is, how do we make sense of this? And we look out and we try and understand consumers, and until we can put those consumers in context, it's really hard to make sense of it. And we kind of look at these signals and this big pile of data, and we believe that buried inside of all of this data is a picture of a consumer. And it's a concept that we call the digital self. And it's made up of all of the signals that we as consumers put out into the system every day. When we shop, when we consume content, when we exchange messages with friends, etc. And that kind of builds a picture of who we are. And I want to get personal here for a second and give you an example of what I mean by the digital self. Now, as I do this, think about your own digital self. Think of the types of things that you do every day, or that the people you deal with as consumers do every day, that might paint a better picture of who they are and what they might want. So this is actually this was my Facebook profile picture a while ago when I was in Honduras, so I hadn't shaved for a couple weeks. That's not how I go to work. So, for myself, personally, when I check the weather every morning and every evening and every weekend for Lehi, Utah, it probably means that I live in Lehi, Utah, which explains why I spend more money on my tractor than my wife's car, and why I have about 22 pair of cowboy boots. And that is a condition that a lot of people talk to me about, but it is the truth. If you were my friend on Facebook, you'd see that I have about 247 friends. You'd see that I'm 46 years old, you see that I'm married, you'd see that I grew up in Little Rock, Arkansas. If you were connected to me on LinkedIn, you'd see that Adobe is the sixth place that I've worked. You'd see that I'm a vice president there. You'd see that I went to Brigham Young University twice, which is another condition we can talk about. You'd see that I'm sort of a technology geek. So I've got about, at last count, I think 12 connected devices in my home between computers, laptops, iPhones, Motorola Atrixes, iPads, Rock Band, Apple TV, et cetera, et cetera. Lots of technology in the home. On these devices, I read books. I'm reading the Boomerang book, Michael Lewis, very interesting book. I read Fortune magazine, I watch CNN, that's my homepage. I love Colbert Report. Again, all of these devices, I'm collecting information about myself, and that's how I consume. Now, a big change in my digital self is that 5 months ago, my wife and I had our first baby girl, which I will use as an excuse if my brain ever goes to mush that, you know, that just happens in the first few months of raising a child. It's kind of fun to be on the road because you actually get a lot of sleep. But my digital profile has changed dramatically in the last 5 months from what it was a year ago. Now when I go to Amazon, what I get are product recommendations for Sophie the teething giraffe. Does anybody in here have a Sophie the teething? Yeah, there we go. A year ago, I had no idea what Sophie the teething giraffe was, and now I think I have like six of them in my house. Big change. Delta knows that I'm a platinum flyer. American Express knows the hotels I stay in. StubHub knows the events I go to. They know that I went to Las Vegas last December to go to the National Finals Rodeo, and people saw me check in there on Facebook. And the one analog thing in my life that I hang on to is I have a rooster. I refuse to get a digital alarm clock, so I have a rooster. So I'm really no different than anybody else. I might have missed it. I'm really no different than anybody else in here. I mean, we all have things that we do that make us us. And we put out these digital signals that define who we are and define who we are not in necessarily in just a persistent way, but in an immediate way, in a way that matters right now. And this is something that we believe is important because it defines the individual. As we become more digital, we build this digital self. But as you extend this, I like to say it's not just about individuals. It's about companies and products and brands. Those also have digital selves. Companies have friends. Companies make comments. Companies associate themselves with other causes. And this is all done digitally. One of the companies that I'm connected to is American Express. I've got several business cards. I've got several personal cards. I'm always checking those balances on my iPad. I'm always on their website. I'm friends with them on Facebook. So a lot of information that I get from American Express, and a lot of information that I in turn give to them. And the reason I do this is because I expect something in return. I expect a personal experience. I expect them to use that in a way that is going to deliver value to me. And I'm going to give you an example here. About 5 weeks ago, I was in Italy with my wife. And yes, we did take the baby. And it's the mush thing. So we took the trip to Italy. And as you know, when you fly from the US to Europe, the cardinal sin is that you don't go to sleep right when you get there. You land in the morning. If you go to your hotel room and go to bed, you're cooked. I mean, your whole vacation, your clock is, you're still trying to figure things out. So we said, we're not going to do that. We went to the hotel. We took a shower. We unpacked and everything. We said, okay, what are we going to do? Well, let's go shopping. And I said, you know, I forgot my sunglasses. So let's go get some sunglasses. So we went. We were walking around Rome shopping for sunglasses. And I found a pair that I wanted. And I gave them to the shopkeeper guy. He rang them up, and he said, how do you want to pay for them? I gave him my American Express card. And he ran the American Express card, and about 30 seconds later, he handed me back, and he said, sir, I'm sorry, it's been declined. And right at that instant, my phone rang. And I picked up my phone, and I looked at it, and it was American Express. I answered, and they said, you know, it was one of those automated messages. And they said, did you just try and make a purchase in Rome, Italy, for about, you know, 150 euros? Click one if yes, click two if no. I clicked one, hung up, put the phone back in my pocket, handed him back the card, and said, can you try it again? He ran it, and it went through. Which, to me, was absolutely phenomenal. I mean, I'm just guffawed at how many back office systems must have been talking to each other in real time. I'm thinking, my gosh, their CRM system, talk to a call system, talk to this merchant system, this point of sale system, and I'm the technology behind this was just amazing. And that was my view, and my wife simply just said, wow, that's cool. And and for her, it was a real emotional connection. She thought, now I don't feel like an idiot. Now I know that, you know, American Express understands me and is going to deliver to me an experience that matches the information that I'm giving them, and the brand was built. From her perspective, she's not a technologist, from her perspective, it was just a great feeling. From my perspective, I was in awe of the technology that was behind that. So through anybody from American Express in here, very well done. That is an experience very sort of technology heavy. I want to talk about how that applies to advertising. Because I really view advertising, us as digital advertisers, digital marketers, as being matchmakers. We're trying to create relationships between the digital selves of the consumers that we're working with and the digital selves of our brands, of our companies, of our products. And that matchmaking process is the human connection that people are really striving for. And from a technology perspective, I kind of look at this as sort of, it's a relationship that happens when the user makes some sort of action, represented here on the left, and then we as a brand or a company have an opportunity to deliver an experience. So we have action and we have experience. And the actions could be a lot of things. It could be I click on a product at a retail site. It could be I read a news story on a publishing site. Today, it could even mean I walk by a coffee shop with a GPS-enabled phone. It could mean my company stock hits a certain price and triggers an alert. The company gets an opportunity to send me a message. But all of those actions are a consumer requesting something. They're saying, interact with me in a great way. Deliver me something that makes a difference, that makes me feel like you know me. And that's where the experience comes in. But right here in the middle, we've got this sort of fuzzy part. And that's what I like to call the last millisecond, where our businesses are made up of a series of milliseconds. And within that time, there are four key questions that we get to ask and we get to answer. We get to ask, what do I know about this visitor? Let me look at all the information I have in my CRM system. Let me look at my behavioral system. Let me look at other third-party sources. But let me collect a picture of the digital self of this individual. And then, once I have that data, what do I predict is the next best thing that I can do for this individual that will help them complete the task that they're trying to complete and will help me drive conversion, will help me drive my business? So then once I know that, now I've got to go access and assemble the content that I have predicted will be the best thing that I can show to this individual. And then I have to deliver it to the individual. And those four things, it's like mind-blowing to most people, but that happens in about 50 milliseconds. And that technology exists. And those 50 milliseconds are what kind of drives this digital marketing, digital advertising experience. And the people that are winning are the people that are really focused on making those last milliseconds matter. So I want to give you a couple of examples. So we're going to talk about a hospitality vendor. So we'll go through each of these. So you come to my site, or I get an opportunity to make an impression to you. I start to think, well, what are the signals? What do I know about this individual? Well, I know that you connect to my ad server. I know that you clicked on an ad for Europe Vacations and you came to my site three weeks ago. I know that 2 weeks ago you actually booked a 5-night stay in London, and while you were on my site, you actually did a search for Paris. And third-party data tells me that you're a frequent traveler for pleasure. Interesting. Okay. What do I predict? I think a Paris destination. That's probably the most likely thing that I can put in front of you at this time. Okay, so I go out and I grab Paris assets. These Paris assets need to be held in elemental form, and I'm going to munge them together. I'm going to dynamically assemble them, and then I'm going to deliver to you what is the result of that experience. Again, all happens in 50 to 100 milliseconds. Let's say I'm a publisher. You come to my site, I've got an opportunity to serve an ad. Well, what do I know about you? Well, I know that you come to my site, you look at about 5 how-to cooking videos every month. I know that a lot of times you come to my site based on the keyword recipe. Third-party data tells me that you're likely a female between 35 and 40. Well, what do I predict? Well, I predict that you are you like to cook at home a lot. And I predict that I've got this CPG advertiser who sells a lot of ingredients to individuals who do home cooking. So I'm going to determine this is the best advertiser to match with this impression. So now I'm going to go grab all of the assets that I need for that advertisement, and I will deliver that to you on my site in the impression, whether it's on your iPad, whether it's on your iPhone, etc. Let's say I'm a telco. Right, you come to my site, CRM data tells me that about 9 months ago you bought a phone from me. Then I can see from behavioral data that a few weeks ago you searched for family plans on my site. Third party data tells me that there's likely a presence of children and it's a married household. What's best? Well, Mother's Day is coming up. My prediction is that you are a very likely candidate for a Mother's Day promotion. So I'm going to assemble the assets for Mother's Day, pull those together, and deliver you an offer for Mother's Day. Now, this all sort of sounds very, a little bit cold and scientific, but the point is that we are all dealing in a digital economy that is driven by these sort of series of milliseconds. And those series of milliseconds are what create the relationships with individuals that both build brand and drive ROI. And that's sort of what we think about all the time at Adobe, is how do we continually help people drive brand, drive that experience, as well as driving ROI. And I guess the message that I would leave you with is that in this world, prototyping never really ends. The Wright brothers were able to prototype and get a design and build an airplane and off it went. Our world is about a continuous testing cycle. It's about living in a series of milliseconds. Milliseconds are driven by the digital selves of the individuals we're trying to touch and matching those digital selves with the brands that we're trying to touch. So I know this is a challenge that in our careers we'll likely never solve, but it's probably one of the most exciting industries that I think any one of us will ever see in our entire lifetime. So it's a real pleasure to be here. I hope that if you have an opportunity to think about these series of milliseconds, that you'll talk to us. This is what we think about all day, and we'd love to bang our heads against the wall with you and see if we can solve it. So with that, thank you very much.